It is useful to make an invertible function from one that is not invertible by restricting its domain. The graph of f of x is shown below. To which intervals could we restrict f of x to get an invertible function? So in order for a function to be invertible, its inverse relationship has to be a function as well. What do I mean by that? Well, let's show that this one right over here is not invertible. And there's a couple of ways you could think about it. F is clearly a function. It passes the vertical line test. Vertical line test, you take a vertical line anywhere on this graph, and it doesn't intersect more than one time. So here it only intersects once. Why does that help us think about whether this is a function? Well, imagine if it did intersect. Imagine if the function was a circle right over here. So imagine if the vertical line did intersect the function twice like this. Well then, what would f of 6 be? Is it 2 or is it negative 2? F of 6 needs to map to a unique value. You need to know what f of 6 is, and here you wouldn't know. So that's the vertical line test for testing whether something is a function. But you could also apply a horizontal line test to test whether it's inverse. The inverse relationship is a function, or whether this is invertible. One way to think about it is if you swap the x and y values here, the graph of this function is going to look something like this. The graph of this function is going to look something like this. So let me see. It's not going to look like that. It's going to look like this. It's going to look like this. Let me draw it as neatly as I can. I think you get the idea. So like that and like that. So it's going to look like that if you were to take the inverse relationship, if you were to swap the x and y's. And now this clearly would not pass the vertical line test. That clearly would not pass the vertical line test. Or another way to think about it is we could just apply a horizontal line test. We could apply a horizontal line test, trying to clean it up a little bit, to our original function to test whether it is invertible. The horizontal line test, it clearly fails. Now, once again, why does that show that that's not invertible? And actually, let me do it on a value that's easier to. Even here, we see a horizontal line is intersecting the function there, 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 and there. Now, why is that a problem? Well, let's just remind ourselves what a function and inverse function do. They're just mappings from the function is a mapping from the domain to the range. So let's say this is the domain. And this is the range. This is the range. And so our function is clearly, let's just take two of these values. Our function takes 2 in the domain and maps it to 2 in the range. So the function does that. F of 2 is 2. We see that right over here. And it takes 6 and it also maps it to 2. F of 6 is also equal to 2. Now this is fine for f being a function, but it introduces a problem when we're trying to take the inverse relationship. The inverse relationship, all of a sudden, if I'm trying to set up f inverse, what should f inverse of 2 be equal to? Should it be equal to 6? So should it be equal to 6? Or should it be equal to 2? And so this is the problem. When you have multiple elements in the domain mapping to the same element in the range, that's OK for being a function. But then when you're trying to map from that element into the range to those multiple elements in the domain, that is no longer a function. This is not invertible. So essentially, when we look at the intervals that we could restrict through to get to an invertible function, it essentially would be intervals where this thing would pass that horizontal line test, where over that interval, every member of that domain, that restricted domain, maps to there's a one-to-one mapping between each member of that domain and a member of the new restricted range, or potentially restricted range. So let's think about these different restricted domains. So if we think about from negative 2 to 2, so from negative 2 to 2, including negative 2 and 2, so this is a closed interval. We have brackets here. Actually, all of these are closed intervals. Notice it does not pass the horizontal line test. F of negative 2 and f of 2 both map to 2. And so we don't know what f inverse of 2 should be. And you could put a horizontal line right over there. It makes it very clear that this is not passing the horizontal line test. So let me clear this up a little bit. So let's rule out the first interval. Now the second one, between 0 and 4. 0 and 4, once again, not passing the horizontal line test. Rule that out. negative 8 to 8. Well, that doesn't even restrict the domain relative to what we had before, so that's not going to work. 6 to 8. Now, this is interesting. Between 6 and 8, you do have a one-to-one mapping between elements of the domain and elements of the range. Notice, between 6 and 8, it does pass the horizontal line test. So this is a legitimate restriction of the domain. So if we restricted the domain of the function to just that, it would be invertible. It would be invertible. In fact, if we could draw its inverse would look like this. So f of 6 is 2. So f inverse of 2 should be 6. And f of 8 is 0. So f inverse of 0 should be 8. So its inverse will look like this. Its inverse would look like this, which is clearly a reflection over the line y equals x. Clearly a reflection over that line. You see it right over here. It's a reflection. And this inverse function is clearly a function. It passes the vertical line test for the same reason this passes the horizontal line test. So this is really good. So let's see, negative 8 to negative 6. Well, yeah, that's the same thing on the other side. So negative 8 to negative 6. Once again, over this interval, we do pass the horizontal line test. So that looks good as well. And then 0 to 2. From 0 to 2, yeah, it does look like over that interval, we pass the horizontal line test. So that looks good as well.